Hello, everyone, and welcome to a book talk series. Yep, y'all probably didn't think I'd ever do that, but I love books, I love reading, and I think it's an amazing thing I should do, and I thought, you know what, I read a ton of books, you know, most of the time, and I should start posting my opinions and stuff on it, but I want y'all to know there's going to be a lot of spoilers in all these I do, so for instance, you see the title of the book I'm doing right now, there's going to be spoilers for that book. So if you aren't too keen on spoilers, you should leave. Go, vamos! So the book I'm going to be doing is 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. And I will say, this is not what I expected it would be. It's kind of amazing what it is. I think it's an amazing book overall, too. It's by Jules Verne, a classic writer, of course. I will get my negatives out of the way because I don't want to just be completely clean, you know what I mean? If there are parts I didn't like, I'm going to tell y'all I didn't like it. So, one negative I had about this book was that there was no tension, really. I mean, there was a bit of tension, but there wasn't a lot of it. There weren't big stakes. That's because this book says it flat out. It says everything it wants to say flat out. It doesn't really... It doesn't make the reader ask questions, you know what I mean? Which is what a huge book or movie should do. It should make you ask questions so you want to read more. And maybe that's because it was published in 1869. It's an older book, so people didn't really need huge tension to, you know, drive their attention spans to the end of the book. So that's probably why it doesn't have that, because it didn't need to, but... For modern day, if you're a modern day reader, it's going to be tougher to get through because the stakes are really low. There's not a huge tension. But I will say this is a lot more imaginative than I thought it would be because it just carries itself in this huge way that I really enjoy. And I just love it. You know what I mean? Another negative that I do have with this book is it's an amazing book. Don't get me wrong. But there's a lot of filler in here. And what I mean when I say filler is... too much object description. Jules Verne likes to give a lot of object description to the point where it's just petty. Like, I don't even care about some of the stuff he talks about. He doesn't have to explain, you know, every 10 fish he sees. You know what I mean? Like, that's kind of, it kind of got on my nerves a bit. And there's not a lot of character description. So a lot of the time I was thinking, what does this character look like? I don't even know what the character looks like. Because he doesn't put character description in here. Like, sometimes I just want to know the color of the guy's hair. I want to know, you know, is he short? Is he tall? I don't necessarily want to imagine myself in this position. I want to imagine the person that the original writer imagined in the position, not me. You know what I mean? So it does, to an extent, matter what your character looks like. You can't just say, okay, well, fill in the blanks. It can look like you, it can look like anyone. Not necessarily, you can't really do that. It was not what I expected, and I said that at the beginning. And the reason why it wasn't what I expected is because I thought the main character was going to be Captain Nemo. Going into this, I thought, you know what, Captain Nemo, the Nautilus. That's all I knew. I knew the Nautilus was a submarine. Captain Nemo was probably the main character. He is not the main character of this book. It's actually M. Aronnax, which I think is his name. Excuse me if I'm saying that wrong. But it's M. Aronnax, and I thought he was actually a really good main character. It starts off on the Abraham Lincoln, Aronnax, Ned Land, and Council, and a bunch of other crew members, of course. But those are the three members that Jules Verne chooses to talk about, and that's because they continue on throughout the entire journey of the book. But there's a huge crew on this ship called the Abraham Lincoln that has set sail in order to find a monster, quote-quote, that is roaming the ocean, taking down ships, and basically killing a bunch of people. And their goal is to find this monster and take it out and become some of the most glorious sailors of all time and learn more stuff. That's what M. Aronnax mainly wants. He wants the research. He wants the knowledge. Council is basically M. Aronnax's servant, right? He does whatever M. Aronnax says. M. Aronnax says. And Ned Land is basically the hunter of the book. And I really enjoyed that fact about him. He was really cool. He was a really cool character. In some scenes, he was less sensical. And then in other scenes, he was really cool. You know what I mean? So when I was reading this, I thought M. Aronnax was Captain Nemo, even when it said his name. And that's because I thought the main story would probably be him eventually changing his name to Captain Nemo, which means he's basically a sailor of the sea. He's this insane guy. And when they found the sea monster, quote, quote, it was the Nautilus, which is, that is what I expected. I thought M. Aronnax would find the Nautilus, which is the sea monster, take it over from whoever was controlling it, and then become Captain Nemo. That was what I thought the story was going to be. But eventually, on the Abraham Lincoln, all three of the Ned Land Council and M. Aronnax fell overboard at some point, and they were swimming on the ocean, or they were like on this little wood board or something, I don't remember, but they were swimming on the ocean and the Nautilus picked them up. And that's when Captain Nemo introduced himself, when they got captured in the cell of the Nautilus. The middle of the book was what felt sort of like filler. I will say the coolest scenes I thought was when they were all in the ocean searching and stuff, like at the bottom of the ocean in these suits. I thought that was really cool. Eventually, Captain Nemo and Aronnax find Atlantis, which Captain Nemo, I think, has already seen at this point, but M. Aronnax explains his experience of, oh, wow, it was amazing that I found this place, you know, and I really enjoyed that section. There's this point where the Nautilus found land, and, Ned Land Council and M. Aronnax get on the land, and Ned Land is just going off, like, hunting for these, he's, like, having the time of his life, hunting for food, and they're not allowed to bring it back to the Nautilus, to the crew. I can't remember why, but none of the crew want this food, so they're just munching down on all the land food that they can get in their mouths. I believe they stayed there for, like, 2 days before heading back to the Nautilus, and they run into people like that inhabit the island that were trying to take them down. So they had to leave. They had to get out. That was one of my favorite scenes of the entire book, when they found land. The actual ending of the book was a little anticlimactic, but I enjoyed it. So that the end was them escaping, Ned Land Council and M. Aronnax escaping from the ship itself, behind Captain Nemo's back in a way. And it sort of leaves it up to interpretation what happens to Captain Nemo. It leaves up, okay, did he die? Did he live? What happened to him? Did he get depressed? Because at some point throughout the book, he loses one of his crew members, and it sort of drives him down this insane, you know, hole where he's like, oh man, I'm going depressed. I'm depression, you know? And it sort of leaves that up to interpretation, but I think he lived, and my interpretation is that he lived. And, this story is basically M. Aronnax, after all of these events from the ship, telling it and what he was not supposed to tell. And I like that about the book, because he's like, over time, it's like, okay, you're going to keep your word, but at what point do you say what you were never supposed to say? And I like that. It's like, you say you're going to keep a secret, but that doesn't mean you're going to keep a secret. You're going to tell if you have the opportunity. You know what the funny thing is, M. Aronnax, it's supposed to be like M. Aronnax wrote the story, like I said. M. Aronnax, if Captain Nemo let them go for free, he probably wouldn't have written this story. Obviously, Jules Verne wrote it, but you know what I mean. M. Aronnax is supposedly the person who's writing it. So he probably would have never told all of Captain Nemo's secrets if Captain Nemo let him go, but he didn't. So that's probably why he kind of kept all the stuff to him on paper. And he wanted to write it down. Overall, I think it's a great book if you're a heavy reader. If you're not a heavy reader, I would suggest maybe read a little bit more modern stuff and then try to get into this. But I think if you want to be a really good reader, you should definitely read this, because it offers a lot to reading itself. There's a lot of words I didn't know. So when I was going into this, I had to look up a lot of words, and I was like, oh wow, that's actually really cool. And it taught me a lot, actually. But yeah, I think it's great, and you should definitely read it. Until next time, I hope you all enjoyed.